Turn now to the teleological argument from the fine-tuning of the universe. Scientists have been stunned by the discovery that the existence of intelligent, interactive life depends upon a complex and delicate balance of fundamental constants and quantities, like the gravitational constant or the amount of entropy in the early universe, which are fine-tuned to a degree that is literally incomprehensible. Now, there are three possibilities debated in the literature for explaining the presence of this remarkable fine-tuning: physical necessity, chance, or design. The question then is, which of these three alternatives is the most plausible? On the basis of the evidence, we may argue, one, the fine-tuning of the universe is due to either physical necessity, chance, or design. Two, it is not due to physical necessity or chance. Three, therefore, it is due to design. Consider then the first alternative, physical necessity. This alternative seems extraordinarily implausible because the constants and quantities are independent of the laws of nature. The laws of nature are consistent with a wide range of the values of these constants and quantities. For example, the most promising candidate for a theory of everything to date, superstring theory or M theory, allows a cosmic landscape of around 10 to the 500th power different universes governed by the present laws of nature, so that it does nothing to render the observed values of the constants and quantities physically necessary. So what about the second alternative, that the fine-tuning is due to chance? The problem with this alternative is that the odds against the universe's being life-permitting are so incomprehensibly great that they cannot be reasonably faced. In order to rescue the alternative of chance, its proponents have therefore been forced to adopt the hypothesis that there exists a sort of world ensemble or multiverse of randomly ordered universes of which our universe is but a part. Now comes the key move. Since observers can exist only in finely tuned worlds, of course we observe our universe to be fine-tuned. So, this explanation of fine-tuning relies on, one, the existence of a specific type of world ensemble, and two, an observer self-selection effect. Now, this explanation, wholly apart from objections to one, faces a very formidable objection to two, namely the Boltzmann brain problem. In order to be observable, the universe need not be fine-tuned for our existence. Indeed, it is vastly more probable that a random fluctuation of mass energy would yield a universe dominated by Boltzmann brain observers than one dominated by ordinary observers like ourselves. In other words, the observer self-selection effect is explanatorily vacuous. As Robin Collins has noted, what needs to be explained is not just intelligent life, but embodied, interactive, intelligent agents like ourselves. Appeal to an observer self-selection effect accomplishes nothing because there's no reason whatever to think that most observable worlds or the most probable observable worlds are worlds in which that kind of observer exists. Indeed, the opposite appears to be true. Most observable worlds will be Boltzmann brain worlds. Since we are presumably not Boltzmann brains, that fact strongly disconfirms a naturalistic world ensemble or multiverse hypothesis. It seems then that the fine-tuning is not plausibly due to physical necessity or chance. Therefore, we ought to prefer the hypothesis of design, unless the design hypothesis can be shown to be just as implausible as its rivals. And I'll leave it up to Professor Carroll to present any such objections.
So let's go to the second argument, the teleological argument from fine-tuning. I'm very happy to admit right off the bat, this is the best argument that the theists have when it comes to cosmology. That's because it plays by the rules. You have phenomena, you have parameters of particle physics and cosmology, and then you have two different models, theism and naturalism, and you want to compare which model is the best fit for the data. I applaud that general approach. Given that, it is still a terrible argument. It is not at all convincing. I will give you 5 quick reasons why theism does not offer a solution to the purported fine-tuning problem. First, I am by no means convinced that there is a fine-tuning problem. And again, Dr. Craig offered no evidence for it. It is certainly true that if you change the parameters of nature, our local conditions that we observe around us would change by a lot. I grant that quickly. I do not grant that, therefore, life could not exist. I will start granting that once someone tells me the conditions under which life can exist. What is the definition of life, for example? If it's just information processing, thinking, or something like that, there's a huge panoply of possibilities. They sound very science fiction-y, but then again, you're the one who's changing the parameters of the universe. The results are going to sound like they come from a science fiction novel. Sadly, we just don't know whether life could exist if the conditions of our universe were very different, because we only see the universe that we see. Secondly, God doesn't need to fine-tune anything. We talk about the parameters of physics and cosmology, the mass of the electron, the strength of gravity, and we say if they weren't the numbers that they were, then life itself could not exist. That really underestimates God by a lot, which is surprising from theists, I think. In theism, life is not purely physical. It's not purely a collection of atoms doing things like it is in naturalism. I would think that no matter what the atoms were doing, God could still create life. God doesn't care what the mass of the electron is. He can do what he wants. The only framework in which you can honestly say that the physical parameters of the universe must take on certain values in order for life to exist is naturalism. The third point is that the fine-tunings that you think are there might go away once you understand the universe better. They might only be apparent. There's a famous example that theists like to give, or even cosmologists who haven't thought about it enough, that the expansion rate of the early universe is tuned to within 1 × 10^60. That's the naive estimate back of the envelope pencil and paper you would do. But in this case, you can do better. You can go into the equations of general relativity, and there is a correct, rigorous derivation of the probability. And when you ask the same question using the correct equations, you find that the probability is 1. All but a set of measure 0 of early universe cosmologies have the right expansion rate to live for a long time and allow life to exist. I can't say that all parameters fit into that paradigm, but until we know the answer, we can't claim that they are definitely finely tuned. Number 4, there's an obvious and easy naturalistic explanation in the form of the cosmological multiverse. People like to worry about the multiverse. It sounds extravagant. I claim the multiverse is amazingly simple. It is not a theory. It is the prediction of physical theories that are themselves quite elegant, small, and self-contained that create universe after universes. There's no reason, no right that we have to expect that the whole entire universe looks like the conditions we have right now. But more importantly, if you take the multiverse as your starting point, you can make predictions. We live in an ensemble, and we should be able to predict the likelihoods that the conditions around us take different forms. So in cosmology papers dealing with the multiverse, you see graphs like this that try to predict the density of dark matter given other conditions in the multiverse. You do not see graphs like this in the theological papers trying to give God credit for explaining the fine-tuning, because theism is not well-defined. Now, Dr. Craig makes a lot about the Boltzmann brain problem, the problem that in the multiverse, we could just be random fluctuations rather than growing in the aftermath of a hot Big Bang. This is a significant misunderstanding of how the multiverse works. The multiverse doesn't say that everything that can possibly happen happens with equal probability. It says that there is a definite history of the multiverse and you can make predictions. Different multiverse models will have different ratios of ordinary observers to random observers. That's a good thing. That helps us distinguish between viable models of the multiverse and non-viable models. And there are plenty of viable models where the Boltzmann brain or random fluctuations do not dominate. Furthermore, just as a little preview of coming attractions, I'm trying to write a paper when I'm not debating about God and cosmology. I'm a physicist, and I'm currently working on a paper that says that actually Boltzmann brains' random fluctuations occur much, much less frequently than we previously believed. It comes down to a better understanding of quantum fluctuations. You know, there's a caricature of theism that says that theism is an excuse to stop thinking. You say that, oh, there's a problem, I don't need to solve it because God will solve it for me. That's clearly false, because many theists think very carefully and very rigorously about many problems. But sometimes there's an element of truth to it. This is an example. You're faced with a Boltzmann brain problem and go, I get out of that by saying that God created a single universe that might have stopped you from thinking about the physics in a deeper way and discovering interesting facts like this. Fifth, and most importantly, theism fails as an explanation. Even if you think the universe is finely tuned and you don't think that naturalism can solve it, theism certainly does not solve it. If you thought it did, if you played the game honestly, what you would say is, here is the universe that I expect to exist under theism. I will compare it to the data and see if it fits. What kind of universe would we expect? And I claim that over and over again, the universe we expect matches the predictions of naturalism, not theism. So the amount of tuning, if you thought that the physical parameters of our universe were tuned in order to allow life to exist, you would expect enough tuning, but not too much. Under naturalism, a physical mechanism could far over-tune by an incredibly large amount that has nothing to do with the existence of life, and that is exactly what we observe. For example, the entropy of the early universe is much, 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 much lower than it needs to be to allow for life. You would expect under theism that the particles and parameters of particle physics would be enough to allow life to exist and have some structure that was designed for some reason, whereas under naturalism you'd expect them to be kind of random and a mess. Guess what? They are kind of random and a mess. You would expect under theism life to play a special role in the universe. Under naturalism you'd expect life to be very insignificant. I hope I don't need to tell you, life is very insignificant as far as the universe is concerned. Here is a photograph from the Hubble Space Telescope of a few hundred out of the hundreds of billions of galaxies in our observable universe. The theistic explanation for cosmological fine-tuning asks you to look at this picture and say, I know why it's like that. It's because I was going to be here, or we were going to be here. But there is nothing in our experience of the universe that justifies the kind of flattering story we like to tell about ourselves. In fact, I would argue that the failure of theism to explain the fine-tuning of the universe is paradigmatic. It helps understand the other ways in which theism fails to be a better theory than naturalism. What you should be doing over and over again is comparing the predictions or expectations under theism to under naturalism. You find that over and over again, naturalism wins. And I'm going to zoom through these. It's not the individual arguments that are important, it's the accumulated effect. If theism were really true, there's no reason for God to be hard to find. He should be perfectly obvious, whereas in naturalism, you might expect people believe in God, but the evidence to be thin on the ground. Under theism, you'd expect that religious beliefs should be universal. There's no reason for God to give special messages to this or that primitive tribe thousands of years ago. Why not give it to anyone? Whereas under naturalism, you'd expect different religious beliefs inconsistent with each other to grow up under different local conditions. Under theism, you'd expect religious doctrines to last a long time in a stable way. Under naturalism, you'd expect them to adapt to social conditions. Under theism, you'd expect the moral teachings of religion to be transcendent, progressive, sexism is wrong, slavery is wrong. Under naturalism, you'd expect that they reflect, once again, local mores, sometimes good rules, sometimes not so good. You'd expect the sacred texts under theism to give us interesting information. Tell us about the germ theory of disease. Tell us to wash our hands before we have dinner. Under naturalism, you'd expect that sacred text to be a mishmash, some really good parts, some poetic parts, and some boring parts and mythological parts. Under theism, you'd expect biological forms to be designed. Under naturalism, they would derive from the twists and turns of evolutionary history. Under theism, minds should be independent of bodies. Under naturalism, your personality should change if you're injured, tired, or you haven't had your cup of coffee yet. Under theism, you'd expect that maybe you can explain the problem of evil. God wants us to have free will, but there shouldn't be random suffering in the universe. Life should be essentially just. And at the end of the day, in theism, you basically expect the universe to be perfect. Under naturalism, it should be kind of a mess. This is very strong empirical evidence. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, but I can explain all of that. I know you can explain all, so can I. It's not hard to come up with ex post facto justifications for why God would have done it that way. Why is it not hard? Because theism is not well defined. That's what computer scientists call a bug, not a feature. Immanuel Kant famously said, there will never be an Isaac Newton for a blade of grass. In other words, sure, you can find some physical explanation for the motion of the planets, but never for something as exquisitely organized and complex as a biological organism. Except, of course, that Charles Darwin then went and did exactly that. We can paraphrase Dr. Craig's message as saying, there will never be an Isaac Newton for the cosmos. But everything we know about the history of science and the current state of physics says we should be much more optimistic than that.
Now, what about that second argument based upon the fine-tuning of the universe? Here, Dr. Carroll expresses skepticism that the fine-tuning is real. But a good many, if not most, of his colleagues would simply disagree with him here. Slide 37 Luke Barnes provides a list of just some of the scientists who have published works in defense of the reality of fine-tuning. And I can think of one more name that we should add to the list, namely Sean Carroll. Listen to what he has to say about the low entropy condition of the early universe, which Robin Collins calls potentially the most outstanding case of fine-tuning. Carroll writes, "If the universe we see is really all there is, with the Big Bang as a low entropy beginning, we seem to be stuck with an uncomfortable fine-tuning problem." And so he tries to explain away this fine-tuning via the world ensemble or multiverse hypothesis. But then, as I argued in my opening speech, he confronts this Boltzmann brain problem once again. Even if Dr. Carroll could show that ordinary observers predominate in life-permitting worlds, what about all of those worlds that are not life-permitting? Because the other constants and quantities are not finely tuned. In such worlds, which vastly outnumber finely tuned worlds, there will be no ordinary observers. And yet there will be untold numbers of Boltzmann brains dominated or produced by thermal fluctuation. So the entire multiverse will be dominated by universes having vastly more Boltzmann brains than ordinary observers like us. And therefore the data on the multiverse hypothesis is incomprehensibly improbable. The evidence is strongly disconfirmatory of the world ensemble hypothesis. Now, Dr. Carroll says that theism does no better, though, in this regard, in accounting for the low entropy condition of the universe. For why, he asks, did God make the entropy of the universe so unnecessarily low in order to create us? Well, I have two responses to this. First, it is no part of the fine-tuning argument to assert that the purpose for which the universe was created is us. There may well be intelligent life created by God scattered throughout the universe. But secondly, as Robin Collins has pointed out, even if a general low entropy condition is not necessary for our existence, it is necessary for the discoverability of the universe. God hasn't given us an instruction manual about how the world works, but what he has done is make a world which is susceptible to rational explanation, exploration, and discovery. And if God wanted to make a universe discoverable by embodied conscious agents, he might well make it in such a low entropy condition. Hear more about that tomorrow when Robin gives his paper.
So going to the teleological argument, it is true, Dr. Craig brings up the point that people disagree with me. It is true. I attempted to give you an argument, not merely an opinion poll. If we're allowed to take opinion polls, I will poll my fellow cosmologists on whether God had anything to do with creating the universe, and I will win by a landslide. But I suspect that Dr. Craig thinks the majority of opinion of cosmologists is important for some issues, but not for others. The entropy of the early universe is exactly backwards when it comes to being an argument for fine-tuning according to theology. Dr. Craig quotes me in a gotcha moment. He quotes me saying, look, the early universe was finely tuned with a low entropy. That is absolutely true. The point that I raised was not that there is not fine-tuning. It's that there's no evidence the fine-tuning is for life to exist. Indeed, the maximum possible entropy of the part of the universe we observe is this huge number, 10 to the 122. The entropy that you would need is a little bit lower than that if you wanted life to exist. But it's almost the same. It's 0.999, et cetera, times the maximum entropy. Whereas the actual entropy of the early universe is enormously smaller than that. There's absolutely no reason why the universe would look like this if the fine-tunings were put there in order for life to exist. I'm not saying there's not fine-tunings, I'm saying they're not there for life. Turning to the multiverse, again, it is a completely speculative thing, but it is a completely natural thing, and I don't really see any argument against that. The multiverse, the idea that outside the universe we see, there could be very different regions with very different physical parameters, is no more radical than the idea there are different planets with different atmospheres. To a frog on a lily pad, that lily pad is its universe. To us in the universe we see, 100 billion galaxies is enough, but it's very, very easy to come up with physical models that have much more out there. The main argument Dr. Craig has against this is the Boltzmann brain argument. Again, I gave you why that's not a good argument, and it seems to have been ignored in Dr. Craig's last speech, namely that both the multiverse does not predict that everything happens. It predicts certain things happen with certain frequencies. So what you do as a working cosmologist is check that your universe is not dominated by Boltzmann brains. Are there multiverse models that pass that test? Yes, there are. It is easily avoided. Then he says, he brings up this weird argument. He says, there could be the regions where ordinary observers could not exist because the parameters are not right, but Boltzmann brains could exist. But the whole point is that Boltzmann brains are forms of life. Boltzmann brains can only exist where life is possible. So what one does in cosmology is look at the multiverse regions where life is possible and counts the number of Boltzmann brains versus ordinary observers. There are models that pass the test. Now, I think that this is a crucial, again, a philosophical point here, because when I talked about the list of ways in which our expectations for theism come out completely wrong when you compare them to the world, Dr. Craig said, well, but that's not the point. We're not arguing about morality and things like that. But again, that misses the point of my argument. I was not actually putting forward these as strong predictions of theism. I was making the point that there are no strong predictions of theism. It's not that there should be no evil in the world if God exists. It's that you can always wriggle out of the prediction that there should be no evil in the world if God exists. That's why it's not a good theory of the world generally. That's not why it's why it is not a good cosmological model particularly. And now Dr. Craig said that we shouldn't expect to know things about the world simply because we say that God finely tuned it. Just because under theism, he says, God made the parameters of the universe such to allow us to allow life to exist, doesn't mean we can have any other expectation for predicting what those parameters are. This reflects something he said on his website earlier. In a similar context, he said, suppose God is more like the cosmic artist who wants to splash his canvas with the extravagance of design, who enjoys creating this fabulous cosmos designed fantastic detail for observers. So what this attitude is saying is that, well, my point is that this is not some sort of sophisticated apologetic strategy. This is an admission of defeat. This is saying we should never expect theism to explain why the universe is one way rather than some other way. You know God. God is an artist. You know artists. They're kind of quirky and unpredictable. We can't expect to know what they're going to do ahead of time. Anything you might possibly observe about the universe, according to this view, I can explain as saying that is what God would have done. In naturalism, on the other hand, you need to play by the rules. When we say in cosmology or physics that a certain parameter is finely tuned, it's not just the parameter looks funny to us, it's that we have a prior set of expectations for what values the parameter should take on, and the parameter doesn't fit those expectations. So we look for physical models that explain it, and that drive to understand things better helps us understand physics better, helps us understand the real world better. So unlike God, who is an artist and can't be predicted, nature is not an artist. Nature plays by the rules. Nature makes predictions. Nature provides explanations.
As to the teleological argument from fine-tuning, he seems to have rested his entire case here on the fact that entropy would be way, way unnecessarily too small on theism. But I gave two responses to that. There may be life throughout the universe, not just us. And secondly, as Robin has pointed out, the low fine entropy condition is suitable for the discoverability of the universe. By contrast, on his view, it is incomprehensibly improbable that we should exist, given the equilibrium or the heat death state at which the universe would more probably exist.
He mentions once again Boltzmann brains, and he says that there should be more Boltzmann brains than ordinary observers. I again explain why that's not true, because it's a model-dependent statement. In this particular model, it turns out to be easier to make a universe than to make a brain. That's a selling point of the model.